Situated in America's heartland among acres of Indiana cornfields is a prison that houses not only the state's most violent offenders, but a large population of the mentally ill, the Wabash Valley Correctional Facility. The challenges of running a maximum security prison are compounded by the increasing number of a new kind of prisoner.
Approximately 700 of the 2,200 offenders we have at this facility are diagnosed with a mental illness. I think these numbers are increasing throughout the country, increasing for everybody to deal with.
Superintendent Craig Hanks has been working at the prison since it opened in 1992.
This is a multi-security level facility. It's a large facility. We're on over 500 acres of property. The perimeter is approximately a mile and a half around the facility. We have maximum security, medium security, and minimum security offenders. What probably sets us apart is the different segregation units.
Offenders who assault staff or other inmates are moved to the secure housing unit, a prison within the prison known as the SHU.
They've been discipline problems, they've been assaulted, they've had issues at other facilities, so they send them here.
Designed to look and function like Pelican Bay, a maximum security prison in California, the SHU is composed of windowless concrete cells measuring 7 by 12 feet. Of the 288 inmates housed here, 179 have been diagnosed by psychiatric staff as mentally ill.
I heard the horror stories of this place back when it first opened up.
Sergeant Dan Haskins is a veteran of the secure housing unit.
Out of sight, out of mind. The outside world, out of sight, out of mind. They probably don't want to know what goes on in here.
The population of the SHU lives on 23-hour lockdown, leaving their cells only for showers and solitary recreation.
Some people will tell you that a segregation unit is not the place for people with mental illness, because we didn't design that particular unit for treatment, particularly for mental health treatment. We just didn't anticipate us having the numbers we have and going the way it's gone.
Although acute cases are referred to the psychiatric unit at a neighboring correctional institution, the staff in the SHU deal with a variety of mental behaviors.
There are those that are dangerous people that you have to be very cautious of when you interact with them.
Inmate Douglas McCombs, who is serving time for burglary, has spent 3 months in the secure housing unit at Wabash.
Since he's been inside the SHU, he was on strip cell. When you see the offender come out of the cell and always wearing his underwear, at that time he was on strip cell. I think it was for resisting staff or trying to assault staff before. So we've had trouble with him on about every range we put him on so far.
See, I've got a mental disorder. They say I do. Okay, they say I've got a mental disorder. They say it's schizophrenic disorder. I can't get along with people too much, especially when they're evil.
Officer Sacken has been working in the SHU since 1997.
An average day in the SHU can be pretty mundane. You have rex and showers to do, chow to serve, MD sick call, so on and so forth. Some days like today do get a little more exciting. We had an offender who became belligerent in the shower.
And the bitch come up here talking crazy to me, okay? She come up here talking to me and started talking to me. Well, you called me a bitch. And I said, what? I said, wait a minute, bitch. I said, I asked you for some money. And I snapped on her, okay?
When we tried to get him to come out of the shower, he was refusing. Then he started throwing toilet water on myself and several other staff members. I got it all through my face, all down my back.
He threatened to kill everybody out there, staff and all. We put him on the wall first. What we say, put him on the wall, have him face the wall. We want him facing the wall. We don't want him turning his head, getting mouthy and this and that. This one you're going to get spit on. We want his nose at the wall. I don't want to talk to him. He can talk to the wall.
Face the wall. Turn around. Face the wall.
Then you got a bitch that wants to sit up here and talk to a motherfucker.
Turn around and face the wall. Face the wall.
Face the wall.
Face the wall.
You just busted
me,
motherfucker.
Look,
I'm tired of you.
Then stand still.
Tony, you're constantly dealing with an evil force that's trying to destroy you. What do you do?
Each one of them's dangerous. I don't care how big, how small they are. They can spit, throw feces, urine, spit blood, or 9 yards.
you can't be scared working in here. You can't let something like that determine how you're going to do your job.
You get up in the morning, you're going to come in here thinking everything's going to be okay. It's not always so. It's a good day and bad days.
I need to go on 11.
11 range?
11 range.
Okay.
Thank you.
There are five psychologists assigned to the SHU. Dr. Mary Ruth Sims routinely checks on the SHU inmates.
I've been here for 7.5 years. What I do is different every single day. Some days I do groups, some days I do individuals, some days it's crisis all day. Hey, did you want me to pick up a letter? Was that meant for me?
Yeah.
How you doing? So I see people when they need to be seen, when they ask to be seen, when somebody else thinks they need to be seen. I will see what's wrong, see what can be done in the institution to help them cope.
The only way I can get out of those moods, I mean, I don't care, you can give me drugs, alcohol, the only way I get out of those moods is through self-treatment.
Okay.
Group therapy in the SHU is conducted with each inmate locked in a separate holding cell. Dr. Sims moderates this small group of self-mutilators.
Once I see my blood, I'm in another world, I'm somebody totally different from myself. I mean, that's the only time I actually, you know, can actually feel real, feel alive, feel like everything's going to be okay.
For me, it's being in control. My whole life, I felt like I wasn't in control. But then when I, at times when I do cut myself, I'm in control of the situation.
There are a group of people that self-injure when they come to prison as a way to control their level of pain. That when they're in so much pain that they don't know what to do, that they're starting to feel like suicide, that self-injury cuts their level of pain down. So it's pain control.
Self-injury really isn't bettering yourself in some people's eyes, but
it's the survival tool that you've developed.
Some people self-injure as a manipulation. They're not getting what they want, and they self-injure, and then it's everybody's attention is focused on them, and people are more willing to do what they want because they've self-injured.
It's like a baby crying wanting his bottle. You give the baby his bottle because it's crying, or it changed his diaper. Me, you give me something sharp to hurt myself with, and then I'm fine.
And we've had people break TVs and cut their throats with them. So we don't want to give people stuff that they're going to use to hurt themselves badly.
One.
To ensure the inmates are not making weapons to harm themselves or others, the staff conducts routine cell searches, also known as shakedowns.
Shakedowns are for many things. We're looking for contraband, we're looking for prohibited property, we're looking for weapons. Everything can be utilized in this facility as a weapon if that's their mindset.
No contraband was found in this inmate cell, but as quickly as one cell is cleared, contraband is passed between inmates using whatever tools they can find. They use what they call kites, which are messages tied to string and cast out like fishing lures.
24 hours set in this cell without communication, without contact from any other human besides officers. A tree. When the last time I saw a tree? Oh, man, years. It's been years. Years. It's been years since I saw a tree.
I don't live under any great idea that we're going to cure everybody, because that isn't true. Sometimes the only goal we can have is to control the person's behavior as much as we can so they don't hurt themselves and don't hurt other people.
Next on Lockup, integrating the mentally ill into general prison population. Most inmates at Wabash prefer general population. For a number of those diagnosed as mentally ill, the only place they feel safe is the SHU.
In population, sometimes mentally ill people get victimized. So some mentally ill people are purposely in the SHU. They do what they need to get in the SHU.
One such action that gets inmates sent to the SHU is self-mutilation.
I did that scar about 10 years ago. I cut it from the ankle all the way up to the hip bone, all the way down to the bone, and I cut across sideways, so the surgeons have to take about 12 hours to sew me up. You got 7 layers of skin you got to go through before you get to the bone. You know, when you're going through one of them phases, you don't even feel the pain, you don't even know you're doing it.
Joe Carr is serving an 8-year sentence for robbery. He is taking antipsychotic medication, and under staff supervision, he agreed to tell us his story.
I was antisocial. I didn't want to be around nobody. I didn't want nobody around me. I wanted to be by myself. Everything made me angry, you know. And I would take a lot of it out on myself, then I would feel better. I was cutting myself up every day, every day, every day. So they ended up putting me in the shoe for hurting myself. And then my time was up in the shoe, and they put me back into the general population. And then I'm going right downhill all over again.
After moving back and forth between the shoe and general population, Joe eventually was diagnosed as bipolar and moved to the Residential Treatment Unit, or RTU. Through counseling and medication, the RTU's ultimate goal is to integrate these inmates into general population. Dennis Prophet is one of the psychologists who works in the unit.
The RTU program is set up on a three-phase system. The initial phase is set up to receive offenders who generally have been isolated from other offenders because of having been living in segregation. So generally in phase one, a person stays to themselves a lot. Phase two is where they're really introduced to the rest of the unit. They have chow together in the day room, they rec together, rehab together, have a lot more groups. So we're getting them oriented to being more socially involved. The final phase is phase three, and it's set up on 10 steps. The first step, allowing them to leave the unit all by themselves if they choose. And then each successive step opens them up a little more to general population. So we're gradually moving them back into dealing with general population and the stress involved.
Joe has spent a year in the RTU.
In the last 6 months, I've been kind of easing out there to like two or three people at a time, you know, that I hang around with or walk and talk with when I'm out for recreation. When I'm on my medication, it don't bother me. Just when I'm not on my medication, I get real, real paranoid, you know, and I'm not gonna let you around me. I'm on about 10 different kinds of medications. I really can't, I don't know the name of them because they're so long, you know, and I've been on it for the last year every day. I haven't missed it. See, they ain't gonna let you miss it here.
Although Joe is involved in ongoing treatment, his most recent self-injury involved swallowing pens.
It's still trying to heal up on my belly here, but they took me to surgery and they cut me open. They had to go in there and take them ink pens out. And then they left one in, so they had to retake me to surgery for the second time to get the other stuff out. And that's why it's taking so long to heal up.
The RTU offers Joe and other inmates constant counseling.
My office is a jail cell. It's a prison cell that's been converted, but it does make me more accessible.
They ain't got no more trust in me, and what they got, they don't believe in me at all. That's how I feel.
Today, Joe is extremely agitated. With Dr. Prophet's help, he tries to find a solution that does not involve cutting himself.
Well, how are you going to manage how you feel for the rest of the evening?
I'm all right. I'm going to put a grievance on him, put his hands on me, and that's over with.
So you're going to go about this the right way, then?
Yeah.
Excellent. I think that people are going to listen to that more than the more outrageous attempts at getting that attention, you know, doing things like self-injury and those sorts of things. So I think you're going to be heard more that way.
All right.
And I'm proud of you for making that decision. I really am. I think you're doing the right thing. I'll be here for another little while, another 45 minutes at least. If you need to holler at me again, please do so, all right?
I'll be all right. I'm just going up. I see you then.
All right. But if you do, you know where to find me, all right?
All right.
All right, man.
All right,
bye. See you later.
All right, but thanks.
But even after marked progress, Joe still has doubts as to whether or not he can function on the outside.
This is all I know right now. This here is my world right now. This is what raised me. 2 years ain't far away. I'm getting out in 2 years.
If Joe leaves prison from the RTU, an aftercare program will be set up at an outpatient treatment center.
Something you think about, it scares you sometimes. You know, you don't want to fail. You want to go out there and do right. But then again, you don't know if it's going to get away from you or not. Because right, this is all you know. You're used to a population of, what, 1,200 people? Then they turn you back into society of millions of people? Are you ready for it? You know, that's something I don't know right now.
Next on Lockup.
There's nothing that goes on that at least one gang member is not involved with. Nothing.
Dealing with threats inside the prison. In a maximum security facility like Wabash, the safety of the officers as well as the inmates is a top priority.
The perimeter is two fences. On the interior fence is a shaker system. In between the fences is a microwave detection system. We have two vehicle patrols. We have seven towers, which make up the exterior security.
One of the most effective tools for prison officials comes to work on four legs.
We also have a canine unit, we have drug detection, tobacco detection, and some aggression-trained dogs also. We use them for patrol inside the facility, and they'll be used for crowd control, they'll be used for situations in open areas.
They are called aggression dogs, and they live and train at the prison.
What I need each one of you guys to do is get in front of each one of the dogs, and I want you to keep 2 to 3 feet distance in front of the dog. I want you to flail your arms, get in a real high voice, high pitch, as high as you can, and just keep agitating the dogs.
This training exercise helps the younger dogs build confidence as they imitate the behavior of the more mature dogs.
We utilize the aggression dogs for protection of staff and offenders. Any chance of serious bodily injury occurring or death, then we utilize the dogs to protect them. We've never had to actually release a dog in our facility, but just sometimes mere presence with the dogs in the yard, a fight gets ready to break out and a dog's in the yard, it may also de-escalate the violence.
While the dogs are used to respond to a threat, prison gangs are the biggest danger to security.
What people don't realize is that almost everything that happens in a prison setting has some sort of gang involvement. Whether it be extortions, intimidations, trafficking of narcotics, there's nothing that goes on that at least one gang member is not involved with. Nothing.
Robbie Marshall is in charge of monitoring the gang activity inside the prison.
I believe we have about 455 confirmed or suspected security threat group members out of 2,000. And that's just the ones that we know about. Right now, our probably most radical group is our white supremacist group, specifically the Aryan Brotherhood. I say that they're the most radical because typically if there's an incident that an assault has occurred in, most of the time you'll see an Aryan Brotherhood behind that. That goes hand in hand with drug trafficking and extortions and intimidations. They're into all of it. The Aryan Brotherhood is very structured, very, very structured. And they've got bylaws, pledges, oaths, creeds, just like any other organization has. They believe in the expansion of the white race. Christopher Ginrich is a confirmed Aryan Brotherhood member.
I've been down 8 years now, down for business burglary, 13 counts. And we was basically burglarizing veterinarian clinics for Special K and PCP, stuff like that.
Since his incarceration in Wabash Valley, Ginrich has been involved in many fights with staff and other inmates.
Say I want to get into a fight with somebody. You know, there's a problem that I have with one of his brothers or whatever. We could make it to where, all right, he's going to shake me down, you know, and I'm going to shake him down. You know what I mean? There are people who are going to shake us down, and our people are going to shake them down, and we're going to go and fight. You know, we can only fight for what we are, and we're white.
Chris currently is in our transition unit. He also has the opportunity to go home within the next 6 months. So far, he's been maintaining a decent conduct behavior. But believe me, we are monitoring him, and will continue until the very day that he goes home.
Even with the Aryan Brotherhood as the major threat in the institution, the gang rarely engages in racial violence.
I wouldn't say that we have a lot of black on white or white on black conflict. Most of the time, our incidents that occur is usually white on white incidents. White supremacy organizations will see that they have a weaker individual amongst their race, and they usually pursue them as an easy target and someone that they can get money off of or have them traffic their drugs for them. Or sometimes they just out and out assault them.
You're looking at your own people like, all right, you know, somebody's saying something, somebody's doing something to where they cause a divide amongst people. So that's the times whenever we say, all right, we need to resolve this. And here, you strengthen yourself to where you could either even the playing field with people, or you want to be the person that's at the top to where you could have more control over your environment.
Another security threat is a group called the Gangster Disciples.
Back in 1999, 2000, 2001, that was the most radical and dominant group that we had here was the Gangster Disciples, and that they were pretty much in control of the whole facility.
36-year-old inmate Bobby Lomax is a confirmed member of the gang.
I first came to the prison system, I had no more than a year. First time going to prison on a dope case, I'm like, man, why they send me to a level 4 high security prison? I could have went to a level 1 on an honor camp. So I got there, met with some of my friends, you know, big fight, gang fights happened. We stayed on lockdown for a long time. I was in one of those state of mind. I didn't care, I ain't had too much time. What could they do to me? But it wasn't like that, cause you get caught with a weapon now, they can charge you with an outside case for having a weapon now. You mess around stabbing somebody, that's another extra 15 years on your record.
I haven't had any problems with Mr. Lomax for some time. He's not been radical recently. I think that in his past he has probably been a little bit more vocal and disorderly.
And I moved away from all that because I did that, done that, been in lockup behind that, been locked up for stabbing cases before, so I leave that all alone.
We spend a lot of time, a lot of effort, a lot of resources on making sure that we stay on top of all of our gang activity. There's always a new group being formed or in the process of being formed. There's always people coming together and wanting to have their control of their environment. And it's something you have to stay on top of and make it part of that balance.
Next on Lockup.
My crime is murder and I cannibalized during the process.
Crimes of the unspeakable.
I heard this voice said, you gotta eat some of her brains for her to become part of you.
While many prisoners at Wabash have committed horrendous acts, both to others and to themselves, you're about to meet two men whose shocking crimes are simply beyond our description. We warn you again, what you're about to hear is extremely graphic.
I believe that people coming into our system, I think, are bringing their illnesses with them. I think that a lot of times they have no structure out in society to make sure they're taking medications and getting treatment.
Within the residential treatment unit of Wabash Valley are some of the most violent and disturbed inmates at the facility. Once again, with the permission from the prison and mental health staff, as well as the inmates, our cameras return to the RTU, where the prisoners tell us their chilling stories.
My name's Howard Franklin Street, Jr. I'm 38 years old. I've been down since 1993 for shooting my mom. I started having delusions that people were out to hurt me. And I came home and I loaded up my dad's 3030 because I thought them people was coming after me, you know? And my mom came running up on me. She says, Frankie, what are you doing? What are you doing? And my mom was charging up, reaching out for the gun. I shot her right in the head with a 3030.
Inmate Frank Street was 26 years old when he killed his mother. But it's what he did after that that's most disturbing.
I've become delusional. I say insane. And I heard this voice said, you gotta eat some of her brains for her to become part of you. I wasn't a sane person who did that back then. You don't eat brains from someone's body if you're sane. Back then I was insane, and I went to prison, and I don't think I should have gone to prison.
Sometimes my feeling is that many courts are having to deal with these people and don't know what to do with them and kind of throw up their hands and say, hey, you know, I have nothing else I can do but send this person to prison, and we end up with them.
Frank is being treated in the residential treatment unit for advanced schizophrenia, regularly receiving medication for his illness.
Probably one of the biggest things that we're able to monitor here and what we watch here is this person taking their medication. Many times, as long as they're taking their medications and keeping their contacts with the mental health professionals, they can function and they do very well.
Prolixin and Haldol and Cogentin, I need medication. Until I die, I may need medication.
Frank also receives counseling to deal with his horrific crime.
You know, I'm not as bad as I used to be. I have problems remembering things or keeping track of mine, but, you know, I'm not acting real crazy or nothing. You know, I'm not really crazy acting anymore, you know. So we all do the best we can. I've gone through up to a gazillion psychiatrists now, and I can talk about it now. Years ago, I couldn't.
Some inmates have a hard time finding mental balance. Timothy Anderson has been in and out of most institutions in the state. In the RTU, he has found some semblance of stability.
Where are you going, boys?
Everybody's mentally ill here, and they're all on medication. That helps me to sort of fit in. They think I'm silly, but they're silly, too. You know, everybody's silly here, so you can sort of just get away with about anything. Sometimes a person gets in my face because I'm a little tall, a little big, and I wish I was really big and strong for sure, you know. And they said, man, you're nothing but a snitch and a bitch. I'm going to kick your ass. I'm going to throw you over there. I said, well, grab a hold of him and see what happens. I said, I'll just strangle you, little pooty ass. I said, I'll just strangle you. That's all. That's what I'm in here for. That's all.
Anderson is being treated for schizophrenia and bipolar disorder.
This is Tommy. I'm Dick Smothers. I'm here to say with the Smothers. Bipolar disorder, you go, it's two poles, right? Hypertension, you're real hyperactive and you just want to stay up all the time, you feel good, right? Then you start dipping. It could be within 5 minutes. And then you go to another pole.
Three big bags. $50 on the dot.
And you just, I just want to kill myself. This is ridiculous. And then, you know, oh man, I'm glad I'm alive, you know. But the lithium carbonate keeps you like this.
Our goal is to get people with mental illness out in general population, to have jobs, to go to school, to do everything anybody else does here. So they're all throughout the facility.
Most of these guys are going to be returning to the streets. Not everyone is sent to prison with a life sentence. And with that in mind, I think I would feel safer and feel better about these people going back to the streets with the kind of skills that we can provide them, instead of just opening the doors when their sentence is done and hoping the best.
There are successful graduates of the RTU program. Terry Mahler has 35 years left on his sentence for a sex offense crime. He was not able to function in general population.
I've been diagnosed with clinical depression, and in extreme stressful situations, I hear voices, noise-induced paranoia, anxiety attacks. Sometimes when you get in a big crowd, you know, your mental illness seems to just explode, and it got to the point where I didn't want to live anymore. I just wanted to kill myself, you know. My mental illness was so bad.
Terry was transferred to the RTU, where he received treatment to help him cope with the stressful environment.
I was given some one-on-one therapy, and I was also put in group therapy. They got me into school. I was able to get my GED, which helped my self-esteem.
Terry now lives in general population. His cellmates also came from the RTU.
It seems like they seem to put us together when we get out here, because we better understand, you know, our illnesses and our little idiosyncrasies that go along with being mentally ill, where a lot of people in general population don't understand that. I wish they had more programs like RTU all over, you know, the country, because a lot of mentally ill people are ending up in prisons.
For inmate Joseph Garner, processing his horrific crime has been the hardest part of his punishment.
I've been down 9.5 years. I've got 22 and a half more to go. My crime is murder, and I cannibalized during the process.
On Christmas night, 1996, Joseph thought his father was preventing the second coming of Christ.
I tackled him from behind and somehow got around behind him and slit his throat. I remember him saying, please don't kill me. And that's when I realized, oh my God, what am I doing? And I said, whatever is done, it's already been done. And I think, you know, by this time, I'm totally wigged out. And I pulled his brain out and took a bite out of it.
Joseph Garner's treatment in the RTU helped him assimilate into the level 4 general population. But still, he struggles with his crime.
Oh, it's heinous. I believe in an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. If I had my way, I believe they should take my life. Even though there were extenuating circumstances that were both mitigating and aggravating, still, having crossed that line, it would therefore be that much easier to go back across. That's always the case. There's less inhibition to take another life now, especially even my own. I've threatened that several times.
In the stressful and often predatory environment of this maximum security prison, the RTU is helping mentally ill inmates live a relatively balanced life and hang on to a thread of hope for the future.
Got me some socks, see? Some hygiene, some food. I'm glad that the people here do their job to the extent that they help you out. They help you out.
Next on Lockup.
He's just going through that stage and developing to that snake that he is.
Shakespeare in the Shoe. Serving time in the Shoe at Wabash means being locked in a 7-by-12-foot cell 23 hours a day.
These places can make a monster. You know, you can come to prison and you can halfway educate yourself on how you're gonna stay out, get an education in life, or you can come in here and learn how to be a better criminal. A lot of people just can't deal with isolation.
Always, man. You read my eyes like parables.
In an attempt to help inmates come to terms with their crimes, one unique program uses literature. This particular group is discussing Macbeth, Shakespeare's tragedy about a general's murderous rise to power and eventual demise.
I'm from the hood, you know, I'm from the hood. And, you know, since I came in contact with Shakespeare, I see a lot of those parallels that correlate with urban life, you know, to urban life of, you know, the 21st century in comparison to, 1600s, the time that Shakespeare wrote the play.
Macbeth, it mirrors my life tragedy, but it also brings about understanding, because when you look into something and you see yourself, you understand yourself, you understand the world.
What is the relationship between Macbeth and Banquo? Shakespeare doesn't fill in that gap. Are they friends? Does he feel some loyalty? Does he feel some ambivalence on the one hand? You know, this is the prince and the father of the prince he has to get rid of.
Professor Laura Bates from Indiana State University has been volunteering in prisons for more than 20 years. She founded a unique program called Shakespeare in the Shoe.
We chose Macbeth as our main text for a lot of important reasons. The idea of looking at the choices that this character makes, someone who is, in Aristotle's terms, a tragic hero. He's a noble man, an honorable man, a good man who made bad choices.
I'm in prison for murder. Got 60 years of the murder that I'm in here on now.
And I say it was risky for Macbeth to recruit these gutter tramps, right? The two murderers, right? They ain't trained enough, and they're going against Banquo, this valiant general, right? What I'm saying is, that's risky. Right.
Everything that he's doing from beginning to end of this play is risky. Once he decided to take that turn to go bad, he got so much to lose, you know what I'm saying? So he's risking everything from that point on. So yeah, he's taking risks.
You know, for every action, there's a reaction. So I can relate to Macbeth, you know, by the choices he made, you know, predicted his punishment. No matter how much he tried to go in and around it to fix it, it just got worse and worse, you know? That's what it's like with our cases, you know. Choices was mistakes, and now we're paying for it.
His mind still ain't fully focused on the deeds of his. Now he just stumbling along, making plans to go along. That's why we make mistakes.
The inmates not only read and discuss Shakespeare, they rewrite scenes in their own words.
Banquo, the song on his radio. Many men was death upon me. Blood in my eye, dog, and I can't see. I'm trying to be what I'm destined to be. And hate is trying to take my life away. Banquo within himself. That 56 song, give me the feeling. Something is not right for tonight's formal death. I've been keeping it real from day one, man. Why am I tripping?
This program being on the shoe is something that's really needed, because I sat here 2.5 years and I seen people mentally just collapse.
All right, Bird.
Hey, play suffocation.
You know what I'm saying?
They say it's built for you to come out one of two ways. You're gonna be as hard as the steel and cement you encaged in, or as soft as the grass you walk on when you leave here.
We are the only group that has a Shakespeare program with a segregated housing unit component, for starters. Then the other special thing that we do is now link up the individuals in that unit who are rewriting Shakespeare's play and linking them with these actors in level 4.
Hey there, Hecate. Shall we fear for our lives? My instinct strings danger. Why do you look on us with such anger?
Have I not reason? For you to act on your own and not consult me is like treason. How dare you scheme and plot on affairs of witchery and death with the skills of mere mortals such as Macbeth?
It's a nice two-way collaboration. I think that's very important for the segregated population in particular, a chance that their voices are heard, that there's an audience awaiting what they're writing. The authors there have been very much aware that they want to speak to the general population through Shakespeare's language.
Let us not make haste. Well, she shall appear again in a time we dare not waste.
This is the first time Iris White, one of the writers of this play, has seen his work performed.
When he was speaking, I knew everything. I knew the words as he was saying it, right? It's crazy to hear it. Like, that's when I told you back there to see the words come to life, make you want to continue to do it. It's like art imitates life, no doubt.
Up next.
I was the lower life of society.
Dealing with the dealers in the methamphetamine unit. Like many states, Indiana has been hit by a growing number of people using and making methamphetamine.
Methamphetamine affects everyone, regardless of social status, regardless of crime. That seems to be a common bond between many of the people we have in our system.
I got 10 years for attempt to manufacture methamphetamines, two armed robbery charges, two forgery charges, a grand theft auto charge. That's not really an excuse for going out and robbing somebody, but when you're high on that meth, it's hard to explain how you feel, and I don't know, it's hard to explain, but it's easy for me to do crazy stuff when I'm high.
Wabash Valley Correctional Facility has unveiled a new weapon against meth dealers and addicts in its system, a drug rehabilitation unit called CLIF. The program had only been open for a few months when our cameras came to visit, but was already operating at full capacity.
Clean life is freedom forever, is what the acronym really stands for. They have to really work to be involved in it. They have homework. They're on the go from about 5 o'clock in the morning till about 10:30, 11 o'clock at night, with activities, groups, education. And what I like about it is the individual that's here has to be here of their own accord. It's voluntary. They have to want to change and want to do something, because it does require them to make a lot of effort.
I stole from my mother, which is my best friend, someone that's been there for me more than anybody in the world. I love my mom a lot.
Offenders come to the program from all over the system and can receive a 6-month sentence reduction with full participation.
I'd like to see something like skilled trades, you know, like Newcastle open up the skilled trades, auto body, something that you could go out here and make an honest living without going out there making $6 an hour, $6.50, and go back to your old thinking of, well, I can't do this, you know, I'm beating myself up, I can't make ends meet, I'm just going to make one quick batch, be done with it, you know what I'm saying, I'll get on my feet and then I'll quit or whatever. And in reality, we all know we can't do that.
I'm most worried about being a convicted felon, going out there and having to rely on a temporary service, making $6, $7 an hour, and paying for house arrest, trying to establish my own residence. That's going to be a real tough thing, because when I leave here, I've lost everything.
Eddie Newland is in prison for manufacturing methamphetamine.
When I look back at where I came from, I was the lower life of society. Even though I didn't think I harmed nobody or done nothing wrong, running around sticking needles in my arms, leaving labs laying in the woods, not having no cares about nobody but myself. If I go back out there and get on drugs, there's no way I'll make it. I know that. There's no ifs, ands, or buts. But if I use this program to my advantage and I get some good foundation and even meet some decent people, sooner or later something will catch a hold of it. I believe that anyhow.
We can give them the tools here to deal with their addiction, but when they get out, they're still going to have a strong support system when they get out, or they'll relapse. They do need to have a family support system or some kind of support system to help hold them accountable when they do get out.
With 10 months left on his sentence, Josie Turner will miss one of the biggest milestones in his life and have a really good reason to stay clean.
My wife's due in 2 weeks. I mean, any time, it could be any day, they should be giving me a phone call or, you know, let me know whether it's born. So, pretty excited about that, you know. That's a big reason I want to stay clean, too, you know. I've got somebody else to take care of now. It's not just me anymore. Can't be selfish. This is my first offense. You know, I'm 21 years old. I ain't never been in trouble before in my life. You know, I'm here. But at least I'm in a program that can help me. And I thank God for that every day. It's a blessing in disguise. You know, I got a little girl on the way, and I don't want to get back out there using. You know, I'll end up dead or back here.
You got, you know, you keep.
Since the CLIF program has been operating less than 1 year, it's too early to tell how successful it will be, but so far the signs are promising.
We start seeing a lot of success already with some of the guys that started when we first opened. We're already seeing a change in their behavior, seeing a change in their attitude, so that's a positive thing.
I know it's crazy to say this, but I'm glad that I'm here because I didn't want something like that to happen. I don't want my mom to have to go to my funeral.
That's what's in here, you know. I can go through 10 of these programs, and if I don't want it, I ain't going to get it. I want it.
No, it's not there.
Officer PJ Walker, you're now relieved. Officer Lushy showed up. He forgot about his in-service date. It was mainly with relief officers that they didn't follow up to make sure that their quarters took the trash up to the gate. Remember, these people are not here because they're responsible. We have to go behind and make sure they get the job done. Everybody, good shift.
Hey, Pat.
Yes, ma'am.
Chow, chow. Chow. You want coffee? Come in. Come in. How many coffees you want?
Two.
regard is so negative. That is just so negative. To me, a guard is descriptive of someone that is not well-trained or well-educated to just an overseer, kind of like in Shawshank Redemption.
Open that cell.
Me neither. You people run this place like a fucking prison.
You get together, you kick out somebody, you beat the hell out of them. There's no education requirements. You just come in and you're guarding. We run a different kind of camp here. And I think it could pretty well be attested to, we don't have as many episodes of violence.
Our job is pretty monotonous. That's the reason why they always want to put the exciting things, the violence and all this other stuff involved in their prison genre movies or TV shows or whatever. We're just here basically to make sure the routine goes uninterrupted.
The hardcore stuff is done out on the streets. We just watch them.
When you're first starting, people, you know, some of the people training you say you're the best paid babysitter in the world, and you really are, because lots of them just act like big, dumb, you know, aggressive kids.
Pull your pants up at least, okay?
There you go.
I
want somebody to see me.
No, I just want them to see it for me, I say. So, you can take your movie star stuff out the way. Come on out. There you go. You can make it better. I can step back.
Somebody's got possible contraband in this cell. Hey, Ramsey, this is Walrath in 1A. Hey, I got an inmate Johnson in here. He's one of the guys who works in community service. He's got an IOC signed off by Sergeant Daniels saying that he can keep certain things in his cell, like scissors. He's got about a dozen pairs of scissors, needles, stuff like that for the community service room. It's at least a year old. Do you want to take it out?
If an inmate gets a ticket, if it's something serious, then it goes before the Rules Infraction Board. Generally, what happens is the inmate comes in, he's read the charges, he's given the opportunity to present his defense. Once the inmate goes in and testifies and presents his side, then the panel deliberates and they determine whether or not he's guilty, and then they can net out a penalty.
Kev Bart, we the members of the Rules of Correction Board voted in penalty for the following charges. For the charge of Class 2, Rule 1, disband on direct order, we find you guilty. For the charge of Class 2, Rule 9, dealing for which any payment of any kind is made, due, or expected, we find you guilty. Penalty imposed, 15 days disciplinary control, in March 14, 2001, out March 28, 2001. Recommend the LC placement. However, we're putting it on the shelf for 90 days. You understand penalty imposed?
Yes, sir.
Wish to appeal?
No, sir.
Step forward and sign documentation. On that, it's underneath my name. You want to be consistent on the penalties that you impose and the discipline that you impose. I think we try and do that here. I think we're pretty consistent. That's the big thing.
Once an inmate goes before the RIB, if he's found guilty, he can be assessed what's called disciplinary control time, which is time back here segregated away from general population.
I wouldn't want to be in here. I mean, you see throughout the day, all these guys do is sit in there. You know?
Oh yeah, you can smell it right here. And it's been scrubbed, I mean like two or three times.
This guy was rubbing human defecation all over himself, man.
located, sir. Could you call us back to the extension 2402?
I don't know. Okay. Guess it's mental. I don't know why he did it.
And one day we caught him putting some feces on his toothbrush, brush his teeth like that.
He took and drew a window on his wall and feces. It was crazy.
I think that's where a lot of the problems in this unit come from. They're in there in their cells and there's nothing to do. And they just go nuts.
Well, on this, look, I've been trying to get this here. Look,
what
this
is it?
I've been on hunger strike. I ain't ate since Friday noon.
Well, what is that for?
Because that population quarter drew, keep messing with my food, calling me PC bitches, all this, making threats and all that. Man, I've been trying to lay back. You know, I've been cool. I've been on.
Well, are you still on that?
Huh?
You still on that?
Yeah. This stuff on cold. Nah. This is the amount of rust you got in the water down here. That's rust. Piece of t-shirt. I stuck this in the hole, right? So you don't hear all the noise. It's just constantly draining. So I stick this up in there. It kind of muffles it a little bit. This white t-shirt since Saturday. Maintenance dude, they repairs on Tuesday. Officer called two times yesterday for repairs. I work maintenance. But that don't hold no note. You let care?
We come to the hole, all we got is t-shirts, drawers, and socks. So everything I got right now is in the vault. We don't got no privacy. Look right here, the toilet. Switch around, see the toilet? Then we got to do stuff like this. Take this.
Do you like those?
Yeah. Ain't enough air in here.
Is it hard to breathe?
Yeah, you can't open the window.
Is it hot in there?
Yeah. See, I'll be looking over here. I'm down there butt naked. See the food? See what we get? See what the fuck we be eating? That's all we got.
Push-ups, chin-ups, pull-ups, walking.
Keeping in shape.
Talking to myself, talking to the birds.
What kind of things do you say to the other birds?
Oh, I just tell them, shut up, quit chirping, making all that goddamn noise. I concentrate on my workout.
What kind of stuff do you say to yourself?
Just keep going, working out, keep going, drive. That's what life's about, drive, dude. Not much else you can say to yourself. Get out of the hole and try to stay out. Getting out of prison anyway, so. It's the nature of the beast, crime and punishment. I can always hope there ain't nothing wrong with that, but it just don't look good. Feel how strong you are.
Let me get that belt, man.
I
I was just pretty much part-time doing construction and doing that part-time. And this came open. Got on here. Been here ever since. Probably been here till I die.
Really? Pretty good package for it. Must stay for a reason, right?
Yeah. Insurance.
Till you die? What's say until you die?
I'm probably going to die young. The good die young, brother. Shoot, I got 22 years left before I can retire.
I'm planning on dying here.
If you stay here long enough, you become this.
Well, I mean, it's prison, you know. You're locked up. 8 hours a day, I'm locked up, the way I see it. I was like, damn, this is crazy.
Well, if they weren't before, this job will make you a different type of person. And it will gradually change your personality.
It makes you incredibly cynical and cautious and distrusting. You're going to forever be bringing your logical and your rational and your normal way of thinking in here, trying to incorporate it in an illogical, irrational, and dysfunctional environment.
It's a balancing act. We have a saying, leave your work problems here and pick up your home life problems at the door and vice versa. If you mix both of them, it's just a bad mix.
Did y'all hear about Mona? Mona got walked out for bringing drugs to this too. I've been on investigation for over 3 years. Inmates a lot of times keep us in check, you know, and inmates gonna turn you over eventually. You mess with that stuff, you do that stuff, you go. That's the bottom line.
Oh yeah, if you can't deal with the stress, you know, I had to deal with that for a while. You know, you'll turn into a real asshole. That's what my wife told me anyways.
When you're going through the grind every day, you get kind of burnt out, tend to take your problems home with you.
If you take this home with you, it'll ruin everything.
You go home and ask you how was your day, and it's like, I don't want to talk about it. Let's talk about something else. How was your day?
He doesn't talk about it a whole lot per se, but you can tell in his actions.
Yeah.
So, for the most part, he keeps it together. Every now and then, you know, he'll blow up, you know, just over something small just because of what he experienced. But when he gets mad and talks, you know, you have to differentiate, you know, it's the family and not the prisoners.
You know, turn that shit off. You're out of there now. You know, turn it off.
These are gentlemen who have separations from general population. They may have felt like they were threatened by certain corrections officers. They have a separation from one person, or there's been a death threat. We have a lot of baby rapers. That's what we call them, child molesters, pedophiles, up in this section too. Child molesters and things are not held in very high regard within the prison population.
Some people here, we have extreme cases of mental problems, you know, in some instances, actually, you know, mental retardation. And as you know, with people like that, a lot of times they're not always responsible for their actions.
I guess he would be kind of functionally retarded. Maybe the guy that's sucking his thumb. He committed a felony, but he's actually very childlike. They take different types of psychotropics. It depends on what they've been diagnosed as having.
It has different reactions. Some of them it makes them sleep like continuous, and other ones, others it makes them rock.
I supposed to be getting out this year sometime.
Oh yeah?
Yeah. Yeah, I got 6 more years to do on a life sentence.
What are you in here for?
Rape.
How long ago was that?
This was back in 96. I think it messes with a person's mind being locked up in a cage like an animal. I've been through psych, I've lost, I guess you say, my mind and shit when I first got my sentence. So I had to go through psych rehabilitation to get back sane, get back my sanity. But other than that, you know, I'm fine and shit. I just, you know, waiting to get out, hoping and praying I'll get out one day.
They're all basically insane. You just see funny stuff.
Like what?
Just the way they talk, the way they act, their mannerisms. You know, we had one guy up there that thought he was the Antichrist. Another guy thought he was Jesus. There was actually a white dude up there thought he was Wesley Snipes. You know, but they were, you know, something wrong in the head with them before they got locked up anyways. So, but, you know, it's free entertainment. But I'm sure it's like that everywhere. No matter where you go, you got to deal with idiots. We have 1,500 of them.
As far as this environment here, 1B is for guys that stay out of trouble. This block is very laid back, it's relaxed, and it kind of runs itself. But, you know, it's just trying to stay out of the way and respect the staff member's job. And there's nothing different about this pod. It's just that the only difference in privileges is that you can take a shower anytime you want. You get an extra visit a month. You can go to the library anytime you want. You can go to the recreation department anytime you want when the hours are called.
It takes stress away from you sometimes when you're pretty much stressed out. She's like almost like a kid herself. She's gonna show you her affection. She's willing to more or less come towards you, more or less come towards you sometimes, and find out what your mood is today, because sometimes your moods can swing by being in a prison. In here, it's almost like a mindset, a macho type thing. Everybody must remain hard, you know what I'm saying? You can see guys sometimes, like, what would normally be a hard type, a dog will come up to her and the first thing she do is wants to pet it. You know what I'm saying? Next thing you know, you hear a grown man talk like a baby. Once again, you know what I'm saying? That's a bridge gap right there.
How long did it take you to build that?
Working time, almost a year. And it's all made out of popsicle sticks and Elmer's glue. Got to use toenail clippers for all your tools, and that's it. Try to get it done by this Christmas, get it out to my granddaughter.
That's the worst part about being locked up, is being away from your family. You can get along with your cellie and everything else, but that's not family, you know? It's nothing like, you know, being able to hoop and holler at the youngins and stuff like that, you know? Or anything.
How long are you in here for?
I got 85 to 250. Hopefully I'm going back to court to get it dropped down to 15 to 60, and that'll be like a reprieve.
This area is used also as a classroom, part-time classroom, to confer GED classes. This is a computer lab that we have. They've got about 20 computers that the college students have access to. Right now they just have a business degree. Actually, it's not even a degree, it's a 2-year business certificate program. A lot of cutbacks. 96, 97 was the year that happened, and we fell from 250 students to 40. you know, money talks. It's budget cuts are everywhere. That's one of the things that has been a negative impact. 98% of these guys are going to get out back on the street someday. Close to 70% don't have a high school diploma or GED when they come in here. Would you rather have them sitting in here playing cards or playing chess in the pod all day long, or would you rather have them have some kind of degree or skill that they can get back out and take back out?
People have to realize it's all well and good to say you want to lock up somebody for the rest of their life. The problem is, if you lock that person up, then you have to deal with that person. You have to feed him, you have to house him, you have to take care of all his medical benefits. There's a lot more involved to it than just turning that key and forgetting about that person.
We got a couple of guys here now. When I first got here, they were kids. I mean, no facial hair, they babies. My children were older than these guys were. And they had they used to put little green stars on their ID badges so that they knew to give them whole milk, so that their daily nutritional requirements were being met. They were just that young. Yeah, Chad, I think Chad and Jones were both about 16. I know, like I said, when I first got here, they were short, and they looked like little bitty kids amongst all these men. I had been here about a year and a half before I ever talked with him at the JLP program, and he was talking to a group of youngsters that they brought in, and I said, "Why are you here?" And he said, "Oh, for murder." And I said, "Well, what about Jones?" He said, "Oh, he's here for murder too." I said, "How much time are you doing?" 20 years, flat time. So you come into the system when you're 16. You do 20 years. 16, you can't see this far, you know? This becomes family. This becomes normal. You don't have to worry about people judging you or looking at you and talking about the baby that you raped, or the woman that you sliced up, or the bank that you robbed, or the cop that you killed. So what happens when he gets out of 20? Technically, 36 is not old. 36 is young. But at 36, he will have never had a driver's license, a checking account, a bill, a responsibility, a baby. Probably never even had a sexual relationship with anyone. And he's supposed to get out now and become productive in society. I venture to say not. I venture to say that he'll probably end up right back in the system.
It's like a paradox, you know? Because the place doesn't make any sense. Because it's not rehabilitation, it's not correction, and it's really not punishment either.
We can't make them rehabilitate. You know, I mean, we can't step on their necks and make them rehabilitate, and they have to really want to do that. And if this is all that they've ever known, they're not going to change.
I'd say at least 95% of the people that get out and come back. 95% of the people that I've seen on the streets, they back in. I watched this guy get a GED. I watched him get a 2-year degree. He said, "One day I'd like to be able to meet you on the streets. You know, you and your family, me and my family, and we could go to somewhere and sit down and have dinner together without me having to look behind my shoulder." You know what I'm saying? I've often dreamed about doing this, you know. I really thought that young man had a chance. He got out, man, and it wasn't 6 months. He had killed somebody. You know, out there trying to, "You know who I am, you know, I'm Tone Deleon," you know, back in jail, prison.